It's Monday night, and you know what that means. Downstairs Entertainment, in association with Davey Boy Productions, presents Rex Rivetter, Private Eye. This season builds on the characters and plot lines from previous episodes, so if you haven't caught up, we recommend you go back and listen to the episodes you've missed. We'll be here when you get back. Welcome back! And now, ladies and gentlemen, Lieutenant Burke in part one of the mid-season finale, Requiem for Innocence.
Burke, Morris. Badge number 626, LAPD. Follow-up incident report. Penal code 187. Four counts. Homicide. On October 12, 1955, officers Wallace, Hale, and Reed were responding to a... Oh, Christ! Burke!
Hello, Inspector!
Rivetter, what do you want?
Much. I was hoping you could help me out with a little something.
Do you just sit around all day and think up new ways to annoy me? The fact that our paths have crossed so many times, I might add, does not put me at your beck and call. What exactly do you imagine goes on here, Rivetter?
So I'm going to put that at a soft maybe on the favor?
I would have thought after the events in your office today, you would want to lay low for a while.
Well, since you brought it up, how is that going? Should I expect any more visits from your cohorts?
With everything that has happened in this office and during your investigations, I would, look for another line of work.
Meaning?
How many times do I have to tell you this? You have been involved in some manner in over a dozen murders, arson, a prostitution ring, and now white slavery. And that's just since March. Who knows what else you've been doing?
Well, I took a few months off.
There are also reports of your involvement with organized crime.
Now that's libel.
No, it's slander. Libel is if it's printed.
Well, I'm liable to take offense in any case. So, what's the LAPD going to do?
It's likely you'll lose your license.
Oh, come on, Lieutenant. That's all circumstantial.
Doesn't matter. This isn't a court of law, Rivetter. Although you should hire yourself a lawyer.
What?
I expect there will be a hearing, resulting in a loss of privileges.
When?
I have a recommendation sitting on my desk. I will submit it to my superior along with a report that I am working on now.
So, that's it?
I would tidy up, Mr. Rivetter. Start boxing your belongings.
I'm working a case.
Finish quickly.
Which leads me to the reason for my call. You ever go to the Derby?
Goodbye, Mr. Rivetter. Where was I? Let's see. At approximately 9:30 a.m., shots were fired. Damn it! How am I supposed to get anything done with all these interruptions?
You say something, Morris? Lieutenant?
What? No. This report is... Never mind. What can I do for you?
It was good seeing you again, Lieutenant.
Yes.
It's been a while.
It has.
I'm about to leave for the day. Care to walk a girl to her car?
I'm sorry, I can't.
Reports?
Yes.
Maybe tomorrow?
Miss... Nancy... We've talked about this.
I know, but... Things could change, right?
It's not likely. You should keep your relationships here at the precinct, professional from now on.
Oh, sure, right. Professional.
Goodbye, Miss Carlson. Please close the door on your way out. I knew from the log that she would be in the hearing this morning. I was hoping to avoid things becoming uncomfortable. Of course, I had no idea at the time that that was the least of my day's worries. The entire world can go topsy-turvy in, what is it, 6-7 hours? Today had started like any other. Shower, dress, coffee, and exit home. Kiss the wife, kiss the children. An ever-increasing stack of cases and a meeting with my superior officer.
Come in, Lieutenant. Have a seat.
Thank you, sir.
I realize it's a little early in the day, but you've been through a few of these before, haven't you, Morris?
Yes, sir.
Then you know what to expect.
Yes.
This is just an informal hearing. The results will determine whether we need to proceed with something more official.
I understand.
Good. Good. Do we need introductions? Robert Galecki, the assistant to the DA.
More like assistant to the assistant. Don't worry. Me and the lieutenant go back a ways.
Of course. And you also know the coroner.
Lieutenant.
Tom.
And that leaves Nancy. We're going to record this interview, but she'll be taking some notes.
Hello, Lieutenant.
Ma'am?
How's your family?
Good. Thank you for asking.
All right. Let's get started, shall we? Recorder is on. This is Captain Harold Ross, Los Angeles Police Department. Lieutenant?
My name is Burke. Morris Burke. Badge number 626. Lieutenant for the Police Department of Los Angeles. Homicide Division.
That's good, Lieutenant. Now, if you would please tell us, in your own words, your understanding of yesterday's events.
Yes, sir. The shooting took place...
Officer-involved shooting?
Of course. The officer-involved shooting took place on October 12th at approximately 9:30 a.m. Officers Reed and Hale were responding to a call about shots being fired at an office building on 3rd and Grand.
The detective.
Yes, sir. One Rex Rivetter.
That's his name?
All right. Let's continue.
When the officers arrived, they were met by Patrolman Wallace.
Stop it.
The three of them advanced upstairs. They were directed to the detective's office by another citizen where they spotted an elderly white male, one Thomas Ludman, on the floor. They later noted that he was deceased.
The shots that had been called in.
They believe so, yes. The officers made their presence known, and there was some gunplay. Suspect Walter Figgs, a white male, mid to late 20s, fired his pistol at Rivetter's secretary but missed. In defense, Rivetter fired and hit Figgs and the second suspect, a white female, 23, by the name of Patricia Bynes, who we have on our records as Jane Doe. She got herself between Rivetter and Figgs. She took several shots to the upper torso and fell to the ground. Officers Reed and Hale discharged their service revolvers in an attempt to stop the male subject.
I completed the final autopsy this morning. There were a few .22 caliber slugs found in the bodies of Figgs and Bynes.
The younger male and the female.
Correct.
Fired by Rivetter.
So it was the gumshoe that killed them.
Possibly. There were also several bullets matching the officers' service revolvers in them, too.
Wow. What a mess.
Well, there's more. A third female, Victoria Ludman, white, wife of the first dead body, picked up one of the discarded pistols and aimed it at Rivetter. The officers believed it was her intent to shoot him. In order to protect Mr. Rivetter, officers Hale and Reed discharged their service revolvers again.
And that was the revolver that was empty. Is that right?
Correct. Mrs. Ludman's gun was empty, but the officers would have no way of knowing that.
That's all right, Lieutenant. Just what was told to you, please. You can add any other tidbits in your own report. All right. Anything else?
Isn't that enough?
No, sir. I believe that is everything I have to report.
Okay. Thank you, Lieutenant. That'll be all for now.
Yes, sir.
We have some time before the next one. I'd like to stretch my legs.
Good idea. I could use some coffee. Nancy, sweetheart, why don't you pour us some?
Fine.
I hope that wasn't too painful.
No.
Good.
I should get back to work.
Tell me, Morris, this kid Hale, he a good egg?
A good egg?
Don't make me spell it out.
He's green. He transferred up from 77th Street a few months ago.
How do you know him?
I came up with his brother.
Hale? Bobby Hale? This kid is Bobby Hale's little brother?
Yes.
I'll be damned. Isn't that something? You keeping an eye on him?
I don't really have time to babysit.
Come on, Maury. You and his brother were as thick as thieves until, what was it the papers called it?
Bloody Christmas.
Yeah, Bloody Christmas. Come on, don't pretend you weren't there. Even through the crowd of blue, I saw you.
Which means you were there too, Galecki.
Sure, but I'm not with the department anymore.
No, you're with the district attorney's office.
Well, I wasn't forced to leave like Hale or some of the other fellas. And I notice you're still hanging around.
It's not like that anymore.
What's he up to now? I heard he had some trouble finding work after the whole mess.
I believed he moved up north.
Yeah. You and Bobby were up and comers. Watch out for these two boys. Isn't that what the cap used to say?
I've changed.
That's right. Found God, from what I hear. Spanning scriptures to ease your pain. I guess I can't blame you. That was one hell of an ordeal. The papers, internal affairs, snooping into everybody's business.
Yes.
All because of a little dust-up.
That little dust-up lasted over an hour and a half. More than 50 officers sworn to uphold the law against 6 young men that were already in custody. It was a slaughter. And a wonder any of them survived.
Get off your high horse. It was insurance and you know that. Those snot-nosed punks beat the crap out of 2 of ours. All because they wouldn't listen. Trojanowski and his partner, what was his name?
Bronson.
Right, Bronson. They were just doing their job, ousting a few drunks from a bar.
I read the report.
Everybody did. Those bastards refused to leave, so our boys did what they had to do.
A fight in the parking lot.
Exactly. You know what it's like out there. They outnumber us, Maury. The thieves, the narcotics, and the reefer pushers, and the rapers. There's more of them than there are of us. Word gets out that a few pissants can take a swat at a cop, and nobody's safe. Trojanowski lost an eye in that bar fight.
Except he never lost an eye. A few stitches, that was all. It was just another tale told by cops. It didn't help it was Christmas Eve. Every policeman in the station was drunk. And that story only made it worse.
It doesn't matter. We had to send a message. You take a swing at one of us, and the full force of the Los Angeles Police Department will rain hellfire down upon you and yours.
54 officers taking turns on 7 innocent men. It was wrong.
Was it? With what we have to face out there every day, we've got to protect each other. Every minute you're out on the streets is a battle. It's us against them.
Us?
I might not wear the badge anymore, but my blood is still LAPD blue. Don't give me that look.
What we did was...
Everybody was in on it. We knew what we were doing, but if it makes you feel better, there was a reckoning. Cops lost their jobs because of those little shits. Is that what did it for you, huh? You start to feel something for that gutter trash? That why you're a little church mouse now? Don't get me wrong. I do my duty just like everybody. I make my Sunday appearances, but I don't go around quoting passages. The whole thing really turned you about face, huh?
The damage I did. It took the better part of an hour to get the blood off of me. Sometimes I close my eyes and I can still see the splatter on my clothes. There were people we are duty-bound to protect.
Duty-bound? Our duty is to uphold the law. Our duty is to protect the people that want to do themselves and each other and us harm. What is it Whiskey Bill calls us? The thin blue line? Hell of a job, isn't it? We're the only thing keeping those animals at bay. At one time, we could at least count on the papers backing us up, but not anymore. Once this got out, not even God could save those men. The papers are more powerful than Scripture. The department's hands were tied. They had to pin it on someone, right? And what did old Hale do? Stepped right up and took the fall. Him and the others saved a bunch of asses by sacrificing their own. Made them heroes in the department, didn't it? But the public crucified them. Villagers with torches and pitchforks. Those same people he swore to protect.
The citizens of this city.
Not this city, Burke. You and me. And the rest of the department, that's who we're here to protect. But we let them take the fall. That's who we're riding shotgun for. That's our real duty. One of us gets in a jam, and the rest of us helps us out, remember?
Things are different for me now.
Well, isn't that convenient? What happened to you, Burke? You used to have something. A backbone. You used to be a good cop. One of the boys. When did that all change, huh?
December 29th, 1951.
December? After you took a few swipes at those boys? That's right. You got yourself into a little trouble, too, didn't you? A few too many drinks at Eli's joint. What? Were you feeling bad about what we've done? There was some talk about it in the precinct. You were driving home, hit and run, right? Kid on a bicycle, wasn't it?
Yes.
And who bailed you out of that? Who came when you called him?
Detective Hale. He was a good cop. A good partner.
Was. Right. But not you. You slunk into the shadows, hiding and biding your time, moving up in the department like none of it ever happened.
I notice you didn't volunteer your part in the whole thing.
No. I'm not the volunteer type. That's probably what makes us such good pals, you and me. Well, one of the things.
We can't change our past. We can only try to be better Christians moving forward.
I'm fine. Right where I am.
What's going to happen to the officers involved in yesterday's shooting?
Those boys? Don't worry about them. We still take care of our own, right, Maury? We gotta look out for one another. Most likely they'll get a slap on the wrist, maybe a note in their file. You remember how that works.
Good.
On the other hand, one never knows. It might depend on whether they're willing to play ball. They keep their noses clean and come when Daddy calls.
Are we through here?
Not quite. I've got something for you. Dragna says you haven't been eating well lately.
I'm, not hungry.
Oh, come on, Maury. What's the matter, huh?
I'd rather not get involved anymore.
You know that's not the way things work. You think that the whole thing on Christmas or with that kid is the worst that can happen? After all we've done together, it's a little late to be growing a conscience here. Don't make a scene, Maury. Just take it.
What does he want?
Nothing too big. Nothing even you can't handle. He's looking for somebody. Some Hollywood schmuck.
Who?
It's in the envelope.
I would prefer not to.
And I would prefer to be William Holden. But we don't always get what we want. Look, Maury, don't make this into anything. There's lots of times he could have called in a favor from you, but he didn't. Maybe it was out of respect for your holy life choices. But just because he hasn't come calling doesn't mean he's forgotten. Jack Dragna doesn't forget. You get me?
Is that a threat?
If that makes you feel better. Bottom line is, you're in. You've been in your whole career. As a matter of fact, the only reason you're where you are in the department is because your old friend Jack Dragna has been looking out for you. Like a big brother. Or maybe an uncle. But his favors come at a price, and it's finally time to start paying up.
No.
Now, Maury, don't be that way. You've had a good career. It would be a shame for anything to come out and ruin it.
You've got nothing on me.
No? What about that little narcotics bust over in Pasadena back in 48? What if it were to slip out that there were some dough missing from that incident? And correct me if I'm wrong, wasn't that about the time you put a down payment on that nice little house of yours? Although, little might be a misnomer. Or what would your wife and kiddies think about your after-work rendezvous with little Miss Nancy Carlson in there? I bet those folks at church might have something to say about that. Your happy little life is a gift, Maury. Don't toss it out over something like pride. You get me? I can't hear you.
Yes.
Good. Now, put the envelope away. Somebody's coming. Hey, 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 you must be Hale. I was just chewing the fat with Lieutenant Burke. Don't worry about him. He always looks like that. Come on in. We've been expecting you. Say hello to the boys.
Damn! After my meeting with Galecki, I returned to my office. The envelope I carried was weighed around my neck. Once I was at my desk, I opened it. No explanation, no directions, just a name. David Hamlish. Even though I'd never heard of him, I knew two things already. If I was being used to locate this man, it meant Hamlish was in hiding. And if Dragna was looking for him, it meant trouble. Visions of a 12-year-old boy on a bicycle riding home from a friend's house were all I could see when I closed my eyes. It was ruled as an accident and covered up by the department. Written off as a solitary blemish in an otherwise stellar career. But it was so much more than that. Everett Thompson. His birthday was just a few months ago. He would have been 16. But he was witness to something that he shouldn't have seen. So, the last envelope I received was complete with a cover story. I was driving home late that evening from a night out with the boys. That became the issue. Not for me, but for Everett. What was he doing out after midnight? A good child should be at home, snug in his bed. I blamed him for the accident, saying if he'd been home like he was supposed to be, none of it would have happened. And when they've gotten enough mileage out of that story, the guilt shifted to his folks. What kind of parent would raise a child that would sneak out at night? I'm not sure how long I sat there with the envelope in my hand. I looked at my watch to find it was almost noon. Mrs. Burke worries enough about me as it is, so going home wasn't an option. Instead, I went to the only place that I thought I could find solace.
Then Judas, which had betrayed him, when he saw that Jesus was condemned, repented himself, and brought again the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders. Oh, hello, my son.
Father?
I'm afraid I was wrapped up in my sermon. I didn't see you.
Oh, forgive me for interrupting.
Not at all. You look troubled.
I would like to talk to you. If you have the time.
There is always time for a member of the Lord's flock. Although I must say I'm a bit surprised to see you.
Is there somewhere else we can speak?
Of course. My office is just down the hall.
No, somewhere else. Bless me, Father, for I have sinned.
Go on.
It's been almost 35 years since my last confession.
30? What has kept you away, my son?
I'm not certain.
One only needs a few things to seek reconciliation. Someone to confess to, a private place to take the confession, a desire to seek forgiveness.
I know.
The will to be better, of course.
Yes, yes, Father. I'm aware. I'm just not certain where to begin.
35 years is a very long time.
Yes.
Do you remember how to give confession?
More or less.
Begin by telling me each sin that separates you from our Holy Father.
I'm not sure I have that kind of time.
I understand, my son. Perhaps we should begin with what brought you in today.
What do you mean?
You are here nearly every Sunday with your family. You sit in the same pew, but each and every week you leave before I have an opportunity to speak with you. There have been plenty of occasions you could have come to confession, but you chose today. Why is that?
You know who I am.
My son, the good Lord sees all. I am merely his mediator.
Maybe this was a mistake.
Do not worry. The confessional is sacred. You may continue without fear.
I have sinned.
All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God.
I have drowned myself in spirits.
Everyone may have a drink now and again, provided it is not to excess.
I have been unfaithful to my wife.
I see. How many times?
I've lost count. There is a young woman at work, and there were others. The number does not matter. I've been unfaithful to my job, the citizens of this city. I've been unfaithful to myself.
Faith is a powerful motivator.
I've taken money from bad men to turn away their activities. I've taken money from good men to keep things from happening to them. I have felt greed and envy in my heart and acted upon those feelings. I have stricken my fellow man in anger. I've committed terrible sins in the heart and in the deed.
But you have come to seek forgiveness.
I have committed murder. In the line of duty. And out of it.
Those are, indeed, great offenses to God. But they are behind you now.
No. No, Father. They are not.
My son?
The things I've done follow me. They stare back at me from the mirror when I shave each morning. Each time I look at my hands, I see sin in them. The devil is crouching at my door.
Temptation chases us all, but we must not give in. All one needs to be forgiven is a desire to be better.
I'm sorry, Father. I don't believe that's true.
In Matthew, we are taught that if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you.
But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. I do not. I cannot forgive some others. Their sins are... they're indefensible, Father. As are my own. I'm afraid I'm wasting your time. I thought I could find what I was looking for in the church, but I see now that's not going to happen.
What is it you seek?
A way back.
To where?
To the man I used to be.
My son. For you to be absolved of your sins, you must seek forgiveness and resolve not to commit the sin again.
I'm sorry, Father. I don't think I can do that. I left the church feeling more lost than I had in years. In an effort to move up in this department, I committed myself to a path a long time ago, and there's no way out. I was no different than David Hamlish, the man Dragna wanted me to find. Our fates were set. The only thing I had a choice in was whether I would be involved in his death or he in mine.
Tonight's episode of Rex Rivetter Private Eye starred Randy Cool and Nick Young as Lieutenant Burke, and featured Solomon Maya as Robert and Mike Martin as Ross, with appearances by Laurie McCunis-Jones, Grant Price, and Alan Hopkins. It was written by Greg McAfee and produced in San Diego, California by Downstairs Entertainment in association with Davy Boy Productions. Rex Rivetter is directed by Rhiannon McAfee with sound engineering and technical direction by Dave Rivas. The Lieutenant Burke theme, Traffic Jam, by the Artie Shaw Orchestra is used with permission of Music Sales Corp. If you enjoyed tonight's episode, please find us on the internet at www.dsentertain.com or on the Facebook or the Twitter. If you love our show, you can donate to production costs at www.patreon.com/RexRiveter and get access to exclusive content like gag reels and outtakes from recording sessions. And be sure to join us for the next episode of Rex Rivetter Private Eye at its special time next Monday night for the mid-season finale, the shocking conclusion of Requiem for Innocence. For Downstairs Entertainment, this is Greg McAfee speaking.